Adolf. At tea time, however, it had hopped a few inches out of its flannel, and there it sat again, uncovered. A little solid cloud of muteness, brown, with unmoving whiskers. Only its side palpitated slightly with life. Darkness came. My father set off to work. The rabbit was still unmoving. Dumb despair was coming over the sisters. A threat of tears before bedtime. Clouds of my mother's anger gathered as she muttered against my father's wantonness. Once more, the rabbit was wrapped in the old pit singlet. But now it was carried into the scullery and put under the copper fireplace, that it might imagine itself inside a burrow. The saucers were placed about 4 or 5 here and there on the floor, so that if the little creature should chance to hop abroad, it could not fail to come upon some food. After this, my mother was allowed to take from the scullery what she wanted, and then she was forbidden to open the door. When morning came and it was light, I went downstairs. Opening the scullery door, I heard a slight scuffle. Then I saw dabbles of milk all over the floor and tiny rabbit droppings in the saucers. And there was the miscreant, his ears showing behind a pair of boots. I peeped at him. He sat bright-eyed and askance, twitching his nose and looking at me while not looking at me. He was alive, very much alive, but still we were afraid to trespass much on his confidence. Father! My father was arrested at the door. Father, the rabbit's alive.